Las Vegas. It's all about the excitement and new beginnings. From entertainment, awesome food, crowds of people, casinos, and other opportunities. Fun fact though, most people who live in Nevada and around Las Vegas were not born there. As a matter of fact, the statistics show only 25% of the people living in Nevada were born there. That's one in four people. And in Las Vegas, Nevada, you know, Las Vegas, that bright light city, the statistics are even lower. But with all that said, this video is not about the statistics of Las Vegas. Welcome back to another episode of True Crimes and Mysteries with Ricochet Reigns. In this episode, we'll explore the murder of Josh Dufort. Before we get into it though, get comfy, grab your favorite suds, and snacky snacks. Let's go. In 2007, a young man named Josh Allen Dufort traveled to Las Vegas for a new beginning and in pursuit of an acting career. Friends and family of Josh would say he was caring, sweet, sarcastic, and smiled all the time. They also said, when Josh walked into a room, people were immediately drawn to him like a magnet. After moving to the Las Vegas area, the Dansville, Michigan native eventually found himself an acting coach, Sherry Flaherty. And I'm not sure if I'm saying her name right, but I'm doing my best. He landed roles in two movies, had roles in a few Las Vegas shows, and obviously was very passionate about his acting career. In his spare time, Josh also enjoyed participating in medieval fighting reenactments. As you can imagine, Josh easily made friends, and in doing so, he met a gal named Shannon Lutz, who at that time worked at a local bakery. They did as many do who are attracted to each other. They became a couple, fell in love, and moved in together. They were literally inseparable. All was good in their world. Josh also loved to work out, and at one point, he mentioned he wanted to try his hand at boxing. But as we all know, and so did Josh, boxing could cause injuries, ones that an aspiring actor wouldn't want. Josh also made other friends, one of which was named Don Juan Futrell. Don Juan was a lightweight boxing champion with a 22-4-6 record. In July of 2007, he fought and beat Hector Camacho, the son of Hector Macho Camacho. Since they both had mutual interests, like boxing and working out, they rapidly became friends. According to Futrell, they were both interested in clothing design and decided to start a clothing line together called Rough Rags. This is where the story takes a turn. Shannon, Josh's girlfriend, said Josh was young and naive, but hungry for any opportunity he can grab a hold of, like creating t-shirts, selling them on the strip, and making bank. You know, lots of money. She also said Josh thought of Don Juan as a big brother and a mentor. So Don Juan and Josh went into business together, or at least that was what was thought. Josh still had the boxing thought in the back of his mind and mentioned it to his acting coach, Sherry. She reminded him of the injuries he could sustain from taking punches in a ring and that he was already booked for several commercials. Josh said he only had to fight 3 rounds, no more, and he could make about $1,000. Josh also surprised her, telling Sherry he had health insurance, which was purchased for him by Don Juan, and that he didn't even have to pay it back. Sherry said she was very surprised and concerned, and according to Josh, DJ told him under Nevada law he needed health insurance for their small business. That sounds a bit fishy, right? I mean, just a little? I mean, I don't know, Red Flag City. On a warm evening, November 7th, 2010, and yes, I said a warm evening, it's Las Vegas, Nevada, hotsy-totsy. Anyway, on a warm evening, November 7th, 2010, while Josh was out at a party with friends, he received a phone call from Don Juan asking him to come over to his house to work out. Josh told his friends he had to go and jogged to Don Juan's house. This would be the last time anyone would see Josh alive. That same night, Shannon attempted to get in touch with Josh and didn't get an answer from his phone. She wasn't too concerned until on November 8th, 2010, early in the morning, she received a phone call from the police asking questions about Josh. In particular, They asked to verify his phone number and that they were investigating a missing persons case. They also said there was a possibility of Josh's involvement. Concerned about the phone call, Shannon jumped in her car and tried to locate Josh. However, she was unsuccessful. Later in the afternoon, Shannon received devastating news. Josh had been located on the side of a road in Henderson, Nevada, a suburb of Las Vegas, approximately 3 miles from Don Juan's house. He had been beaten and strangled. After Josh was found, it was thought he had been robbed. However, none of his personal belongings had been taken, including a set of wired headphones, which he was strangled with. After the news about Josh's death, his friends gathered together to console each other. This also included DJ. Just before DJ left the gathering, he mentioned he had 3 voice messages from the night Josh was killed, and they were from Josh. DJ said the voice messages went something like this. The first one was,
"These guys are here. I don't know what to do."
The second,
"I don't know how to get into the gate, and they're following me."
DJ said the third phone call came when Josh was on the corner of Southeastern and Pecos Ridge Parkway, and that he was frantic. DJ continued, stating Josh's last message was,
"You need to come and get me right now. These guys are following me."
DJ said he repeated it several times, and then the phone went silent. Now, my first thought would be to immediately get the voice messages to the police. If not when it was happening, he should have reported the voice messages after he found out what happened to Josh. I mean, they were great friends, right? The following day, the police went to DJ's home and seized his computers and cell phones. While gathering the evidence from DJ's home, the police discovered 2 insurance policies taken out in Josh's name. Remember that health insurance coverage Josh spoke about? Anyway, the value of the insurance policies, you're not going to believe this, the value was worth $1.7 million, and the beneficiary of the policy was, you probably guessed it, DJ. DJ attempted to collect on the policies, which was refused by the insurance companies. They denied payment, and one of the companies, American General Life Insurance, ended up filing a lawsuit against him. In a deposition, DJ said he had no idea he was the beneficiary of the policies until after Josh's death. Both insurance applications falsely claimed that Josh had an annual salary of $180,000 working for a company that DJ and Josh supposedly owned called Rough Rags. Josh, according to the insurance application, made a profitable living selling t-shirts on the Las Vegas Strip. There was also a voice recording provided by one of the insurance companies where the person speaking said his name was Josh Dufort. However, after checking the voice recording, it was verified not to be Josh. The voice on the recording was proven to be that of DJ's brother. And if that wasn't enough of a shock, in a bizarre twist, the policy listed Josh and DJ as domestic partners. Pretty strange, as DJ had 5 sons at that time. Now, I'm not saying they couldn't have had a relationship, but it's highly, and I say highly, unlikely, like 99.99999 into infinity, highly unlikely. After discovering all of this information, neither DJ nor his brother were charged with insurance fraud, since DJ was unable to collect on the policies. And to top it off, even though the police believed DJ was their prime suspect, they had no hard evidence that he was involved in Josh's death. To this very day, in 2021, this case remains open. So what do you think? Do you think DJ had Josh killed for the insurance money? Or is it just a coincidence about the attempted insurance fraud? Or did someone try to rob Josh and go too far, leaving all his valuables behind? His wallet and iPod was still with Josh when he was found, along with the wired headset that was used to strangle him. Also, why didn't DJ take action when he received the voice messages? I mean, wasn't he waiting for Josh to arrive? After all, DJ called Josh and asked him to come over to his house. Leave your thoughts in the comments below. And if you haven't already, don't forget to like, subscribe, hit that bell button thingy, and follow us. You don't want to miss an episode. As always, thanks for joining us for another episode of True Crimes and Mysteries with Ricochet Reigns. We'll see you real soon.